God, I want to thank you for allowing us to come here today, for the ones to be here today. And for the ones that aren't here today, God, we just keep watch over them. And you know, just be by their side, Lord. Help them with what's ailing them. And just be with us through this week, Lord. Keep us safe with this evening. If we can have a little rain, we sure appreciate it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
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 Being hot, being sober, being hot.
Supposed to be real cool one day this next week.
I'll take it. I know last week we've been talking about grace and this new study, and what's different about this study than the other ones is that it's a lot of discussion, because last week, we got a discussion, and I think Christy talked about sacrifice for husband going overseas. The other family when they moved back and living with them and stuff. And so what I did is I went and looked up and went to Christianity.com, and some of the ways people has defined grace is grace is free sovereign favor to the ill-deserving, which I think a lot of people see that, the story of God, the woman brought to him, to Jesus, who was good. Being accused of adultery, caught the act, and he knelt below her, below the whole crowd, riding in the dirt, said, "Those without sin, cast first stone," and that was a sign of grace. And I got to thinking of when he was on the cross, and these people that were around him had beaten him, ridiculed him, laughed at him, mocked him, auctioned off, and was gambling away with his belongings and whatnot. And even at the end, was asking God to forgive him, for they know not what they do. Grace is love that cares and stoops and rescues. Grace is God reaching down to people who are in rebellion against him. Grace is unconditional love toward a person who does not deserve it. And I think that's a hard one it's true, but I think it's hard for a lot of people because there are certain situations that I don't know how you forgive someone. I've seen, crime documentaries and whatnot where a child's been killed or a loved one's been killed, and the family of the loved one is, asking, like, "I forgive him, I'm gone," and so forth. And I think that would be more for someone like me to do. I don't like to think that I'm capable of it. Those are some of the things that I think grace, is when I think of grace, it's what I think. It's something that, I don't deserve it, but I don't know why I'm getting it, but I am, and hopefully I can make the best of it. So let's go ahead and watch this next little episode. Like I said, I think it's only maybe 7 minutes long for the moment. This is what it says here, but I may be wrong.
Accomplishments receive applause. Well, the guys envy. My female classmates manage to keep their hands to themselves only by virtue of extreme self-control. I knew they secretly longed to run a finger over my signaling badge and to ask me to spell their names in Morse code. Well, I became a Christian about the same time that I became a Boy Scout, and I made the logical assumption that God grades on a merit system. The good scouts move up, right? And good people do the same. Good people go to heaven. So I resolved to amass a multitude of spiritual merit badges, an embroidered Bible for Bible reading, folded hands for prayer, a kid sleeping on the pew for church attendance. In my imagination, angels feverishly stitched emblems on my back, and they scarcely could keep pace with my performance. Like they were wondering if one sash would suffice. I could just hear the angels saying that placato kid is exhausting my fingers. And I had worked toward the day, the great day, when God, amidst falling confetti and dancing cherubim, would drape my badge-laden sash across my chest and welcome me into his eternal kingdom, where I could humbly display my badges. But then some foreign questions began to surface. For example, if God saves good people, how good is good? I mean, God expects integrity of speech, but how much? What is the percentage of allowed exaggeration? Suppose the required score is 80 and I score 79. And how do you know your score? I sought the advice of a minister. Surely he would help me with the how good is good question. He did. He said, just do. Do better, do more, do now. Do good and you'll be okay. Do more and you'll be saved. Do right and you'll be all right. Do, be. Do, be, do. Do, be, do, be, do. Maybe you're familiar with the tune. You might be. Most people embrace the assumption that God saves good people. So, for heaven's sake, be good. Be moral. Be honest. Be decent. Pray the rosary. Keep the Sabbath. Keep your promises. Pray five times a day facing east. Pay taxes. Stay sober. Earn your merit badges. Yet, for all this talk about being good, still no one can answer the fundamental question. What level of good is good enough? Don't you think that's bizarre? At stake is our eternal destination. Yet we're more confident about lasagna recipes than we are the entrance requirements for heaven. But God has a better idea. He gives us this invitation. For by grace, you have been saved through faith. And that is not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. You see, we contribute nothing. Zilch. As opposed to the merit badge of the scout, salvation of the soul is unearned, a gift. Our merits merit nothing. God's work merits everything. Why don't you saturate your heart in this? The finest summary of God's greatest accomplishment. God, in his gracious kindness, declares us not guilty. He has done this through Christ Jesus, who has taken away our sins. For God sent Jesus to take away the punishment of our sins and to satisfy God's anger against us. We are made right with God when we believe that Jesus shed his blood, sacrificing his life for mine. You see, God did not overlook your sins, lest he endorse them. He didn't punish you, lest he destroy you. He instead found a way to punish the sin and preserve the sinner. Jesus took your punishment, and God gave you credit for Jesus' perfection. This is grace. Accept this gift of grace. Make it your personal gift. You see, as long as grace is God's gift to the world, it really will not touch you. It won't change you. Precious as it is to proclaim, Christ died for the world, even sweeter it is to whisper, Christ died for me. For my sins, he died. He took my place. He carried my sins. He carried today's hard-heartedness, today's anger. Through the cross, he claimed He cleansed. He called me. He felt my shame. He spoke my name. Why don't you receive this grace? Your marriage merits love. For God's merit, well, it merits everything. Thank God for the day that Jesus took your place, for the day that grace happened to you.
Talk about earning things. I know that when I was younger, it was a lot different. It was like, you know, I was trying to do a lot of things that were good too, especially when I thought that that's how you do it, you know? You got to get these.
You got to be good.
Yeah, you got to build up these trophies. And then one of the questions here is, which of your habits are results of trying to earn grace? Is one of the questions that's asked. Another one is, besides God's grace, have you ever received something free with no strings attached? Your habits, I'm trying to, I thought that, hope, something as simple as helping the world for somebody, doing little things like that. Helping people where I can, I thought I was doing it for, because I was trying to build a truck, do things like that. Later on, I really got to thinking about it. The older I got, the more I learned. I feel it's the right thing to do, not because I was trying to build a trophy. It was a lot easier to do it. I think sometimes when we get into, trying to earn that grace and build up things are a lot easier to do when you're doing it for the right reason. And that was just something personal for me. Another thing, here's something from Ephesians. Ephesians 2:8-9. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. That's pretty important there is, it's saved through faith, from the embrace of God on the cross. Another one that I've always it's always came back to me, something I came across a while ago, and I just been stuck. 1 Timothy 1, verse 5, book written by Paul. States, here's a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into this world to save sinners, for who I am the worst. Other versions will say, for who I am chief. And I think sometimes we feel like, we're undeserving, like there's no way to forgive me for that. He did. When I was at a church for a long time, not going, and I had different aspects on life and views. Church in general at the time, and just, when something clicked and I started thinking about it, I was like, well, how can not me? I was thinking, not that I became a non-Christian, I was just, my views on certain things were just different. I just didn't think that I could ever hit that point where I was deserving enough of that as I felt when I was, a young boy, with my mom and dad at that couch that night, accepting Christ.
Well,
I know when I was 12 years old when I was when I gave my myself to God, but I left there thinking, now everything's supposed to be different. But I didn't know what to do to make it different. You know, I didn't know enough about it, and nobody explained anything to me. I just knew that, you know, I couldn't lie and I couldn't steal. Just those things.
Yeah, but you knew that before you turned 12 years old.
Exactly. You know, and I thought, well, it is supposed to be different. And I just didn't know enough about it to be different.
And I think sometimes, too, that we, as a people in general, can overcomplicate things.
Mm-hmm. And I know as a child in a Methodist church, and I think they probably still do this in some other churches, they had this class that we all went to, and I was saved a year earlier because I got to go with a group that was older than me. Yeah. You know, but it all depended on who I was with, and not as much as what I felt. It's like you said, I knew what I needed to feel, but I didn't know I felt that. So.
No, I remember I went to a church camp, mm-hmm. and when I got back, I was really excited. Everything. And then, you know, I was still young. I was 14, 16, turned 15. And, you know, so I sent out my buddies and stuff. And then, you know, that tug of war that we had. And I would go back and forth and get guilty of it. Doing what was fun, doing what was borderline, getting in trouble, doing what was right, and more complex aside. And then going to pray about it. It's gonna work this time, you know. And I think that, you know, for me it's always been, you know, I guess, is he ever gonna say no? You know, and I think you were good. I think it also, as long as it's honest and truthful, it's from the heart, yes, it shows strength. The question you had here is how do God's grace and our faith work together? To equal salvation. And it's followed up here with Romans 3, 21 through 26, and one verse here, 3:23, which I think a lot of people are familiar with. I'll go ahead and read it. But now, righteousness of God apart from the law is revealed through our faith in Jesus Christ to all and on all who believe. For there is no difference between Jews and Gentiles. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ. Jesus, whom God set forth as a propitiation by his blood, his faith, demonstrated his righteousness because of his forbearance. God has passed over the sins that were previously committed, demonstrated present time is righteousness. And I think that that's a, and to be honest with you, I've never read that whole passage. Obviously, 3:23, for all of sin. You know, the ending of that, how he passes over all of our previous sins to meet us in the here and the now. That's grace in a nutshell when we're going to God. And we do ask for that forgiveness, you know, no matter where we are in life, things that we've done, like, you know, when it's real, all that's gone. And he's in the here and the now. Just like when he was on the cross and he had the two others next to him. One denied him and one asked for him. And he was given. So, I think for us, even you know, I think it's for, and you know, I hear stories, and I've heard people tell stories about, you know, preachers, you know, having a friend that was never in church, never saved, and you know, on their deathbed, and still not good, you know, thinking that, you know, the one in particular that I heard, you know, he was sitting there and he was talking to his friend and it was.
done for years of denial. So I'll just go. So, and I think there are a lot of people that have lost hope or don't believe that God will skip over all the things you've done.
Well, it's hard to believe that he's going to forgive you for some stuff you've done, you know.
No, especially this week, I heard a pastor on the radio, and he said that every thought that we thought, every word that we said, he knows, and we'll have to stand accordingly one day to be judged for that.
Yeah, and we will.
All the wrong, everything. And I started thinking, well, what in the world? That's all thought, you know. Because sometimes you think things before, and you don't even say them, but you think them. You know.
Probably all the times you believe Tim does know me.
You got out of murder, Bob.
Anything about nothing. Mm-hmm. What you talking about? Remember the church.
In God's case, his memory is short, but it's not the case with mom and daddy. He has a short memory. I don't know how you get, you know, hold anything. Yeah.
And you know that's actually this is pretty good, yeah, because, like, you know, at that time, you know, he's here now, and once he's there, you know, he's always there, he's just waiting for you to ask me. Another question here, and we'll try to wrap this up pretty quick, is, have you ever felt like there are certain things you need to do in order to be a Christian? I think we talked a little bit about that earlier, you know, that I think there's things that I had to do, the church was open, Wednesday nights, I had to be there on Wednesday nights. I had to be there Sunday morning. And Sunday
something evening. Something I don't do that I need to do, pray.
Yeah. And, you know, and prayer is real simple. And the last, funny to say that, the last episode, the one we studied we did was on prayer and how simple it could be. Simple as, you know, God, you know, you are great. I need help. They need help. And you're not
when we
help.
Always pray when we need help.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, I just think we don't need to miss one opportunity that we may have to share with others about Jesus.
Yeah, that's an important one. And I think it's good. I used to think that, you know, I needed to talk about it all the time when I was younger. And I think that the older I got, I think my example is talking to a point. You know, that when it's brought up, to not pass up that opportunity. That old saying, your actions speak louder than your words. A lot of people can talk the game, but can you show the game?
Can you walk it?
Yes. So I think that's important.
These kids that you coach watch you.
Oh, yeah, they do.
They'll call you in a minute, too.
Oh, they will.
Just like kids watching parents.
Mm-hmm. I said something to kids. I'm not your bro, dude. I'm not dude. Get smart about people. Then, you know, he walked out and I was like, okay.
I'm not sure I could be a teacher now.
When? We'll find out.
Back
when
we
were in school.
You're a
good teacher,
yeah.
You've done everything, so they can't get by with nothing. You already know about it.
That's right. You already know what they got in their mind doing.
Read
their
mind.
Yeah,
they don't realize that.
No, they don't. But they're fixing to. Hopefully, they still will. They'll deny. Can't hear me. I can hear everything.
Kids are a lot bolder now than they were. When I was growing up, you didn't speak unless you were. You raise your hand.
Well, that's how you're raised. You
know, yes, right. That's and it started at the home.
That's right.
Yeah,
right.
Which it doesn't do that now too much. That's
a deep, long conversation right there. Mm-hmm. But, that's all I have for this week. And Mom, can you break us out?
Dear Heavenly Father, I just thank you for this day, the day that you have made for us, Father. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us go away from here, Father God, and think about what we can do to serve you the best that we can, Father. We thank you. For it's in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.